Church, we're glad you're here this morning. The song they were playing is Open My Eyes, Lord. We want to see Jesus. And this morning, as we look into God's Word, we will certainly see Him in the pages of Scripture. This morning, we are using technology. We are live streaming to Facebook. We're also recording for YouTube so that we can save a video and email the link to that YouTube video. First time doing that. And so pray that everything goes well and it works like we want it to there. We're going to have some songs. Our first one is My Hope is in the Lord. And with everything going on around the world today, and with everyone trying to do what they can do, we know that our hope is not in our government for sure. It's not in man. Our hope is in the Lord. Nathan will come and lead us. It's hymn number 336. You join in as we sing together.
Those of you at home, also make sure you sing along with us. We can all worship together. Let's stand together as we sing 336. My hope is in the Lord.
Whether there are lost people to evangelize, Lord, help us to do all things so that you might be exalted and glorified through our efforts, we pray in Christ's name. Amen. You may be seated. I have just a couple of announcements for you to share. Our choir is not singing today, but you'll notice the announcements in your bulletin. I have emailed that to all of our church families there. This coming Wednesday night, we're not going to meet. The bulletin says we have prayer time. We will pray at home this coming Wednesday. We'll not have anything live stream or recorded there Wednesday night. And no choir practice today, and no evening service today as well. We'll not have anything recorded or live stream tonight either. Our Missions Emphasis Month is continuing. If you have not yet completed one of the blue sheets to designate an amount you would like to give for our Missions Month, if you'll do that, and our Missions Committee tentatively plans to meet April 8th, if everything goes well, so we can begin making plans for increasing the giving to some of our missionaries, or possibly adding some, whatever the Lord directs us through the Missions Committee. So be in prayer for our missionaries all around the world. 20-something we helped to support and sent out email yesterday, forwarded one from the Barons in China. And so pray that you would continue to pray for them as they minister as well. Nathan's going to come and lead us in our next song. And hymn number is 485, Sunlight in My Soul. Regardless of what's happening around us, we can still have sunlight in the soul because of the Lord Jesus Christ within. Amen.
Let's all stand again together and sing 485, Sunlight in My Soul.
Thank you.
Thank you, Steve. Our scripture reading this morning is from John chapter 1, and you can join in with me. You'll see the words behind me on the screen. I'll read the odd number verses. You can read the even number verses as we begin from John chapter 7, verse 1. After these things, Jesus walked in Galilee, for he would not walk in Judea, because the Jews sought to kill him. His brethren therefore said unto him, Depart hence, and go into Judea, that thy disciples also may see the works that thou doest.
For there is no man that doeth anything in secret, and he himself seeketh to be known openly. If thou do these things, show thyself to the world.
For neither did his brethren believe in him.
Then Jesus said unto them, My time is not yet come, but your time is already ready.
The world cannot hate you, but it hated me, it hated, because I testify of it that the works thereof are evil.
Go ye up unto this feast. I go not up yet unto this feast, for my time is not yet full come.
When he had said these words unto them, he abode still in Galilee.
But when his brethren were gone up, then went he also up unto the feast, not openly, but as it were in secret.
Then the Jews saw him at the feast and said, Where is he?
And there was much murmuring among the people concerning him. For some said, He is a good man. Others said, Nay, but he deceiveth the people.
Howbeit, no man spake openly of him for fear of the Jews.
Now about the midst of the feast, Jesus went up into the temple and taught.
Amen. Thank the Lord for his word. Nathan will come and lead us in one more song, 332, The Savior is Waiting.
Let's all stand together again as we sing, The Savior is Waiting.
Turn out all right.
Brittany Allega is going to come and play a song on the violin for us. Chair. There we go. Now we have your attention. We will turn in our Bibles to John chapter 7. Last week we were looking and finished up John chapter 6, where we saw Jesus telling the crowd that he is the bread of life. And after that, Jesus goes to the tabernacle, to the temple, that is, and during the time of the Feast of Tabernacles. And as we look at this chapter this morning, we're going to see seven different aspects of his teaching there at the temple. Let's go to the Lord in prayer, and then we'll look at Jesus during the Feast of the Tabernacles. Father, thank you again for your word. We thank you that it is eternal, that it is infallible, that it is relevant for today. It speaks to our hearts, and so we pray that the word of God will meet the need of each heart this morning, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. As we begin looking at this, we're going to see the desire of the Jews during this time. And in verse 1, it says that they sought to kill him there. Now, not all of the Jews were seeking this, but they didn't like the message. They didn't like that he was telling them that they were sinners there. And so we'll see a couple of different desires here. And one was to remove him. Now, these particular Jews were his brothers. His brothers were telling him to get out of here. They knew that people were seeking to kill him, and they weren't believers at this time, but they said, go ahead and leave. You know, and there are people today that want to do the same thing. They want to get rid of Jesus. They want to get rid of him even at Christmas time. They want to rid him and his influence out of society today, and a lot of times that's because guilt and conviction. And no doubt that's what these people were feeling as Jesus was preaching to them. They were guilty of sin, and they were under conviction there. And so they were doing what was humanly possible for them to do, at least try to do, and that was to get rid of him. Well, there were some Jews that were there to remember God, because it was the Feast of the Tabernacles, and this was a harvest feast. And the Feast of Tabernacles was held to commemorate the wilderness wanderings. And as they think back of all the times that they had wandered in the wilderness, and in those times they had the tabernacle that they set up, and they had booths that were set up, and that word booth and tabernacle are similar there. And so it's reminding them there was a time where we were pilgrims through our wilderness land, and we would take up our tents and we would go somewhere else. And aren't we pilgrims today in this land? This is not our home. We have an eternal heavenly home when we know the Lord Jesus Christ is our Savior there. And there's coming a time where we as Christians will not be wandering and roaming this earth anymore. But there's no neutral ground. Jesus says, you're either with me or you're against me. And so here were some that were trying to put him to death and kill him there. And even today, a person is either with the Lord Jesus Christ or he is against him. There is no neutral ground, for he indeed is the only way of salvation. So they were trying to put him to death, but it wasn't his time to die. And he was able to choose when he would die and how he would die. We don't get that choice. We don't know when we're going to die or how we're going to die. But Jesus knew, and it tells us later that it wasn't his time there. And eventually he would, and we'll get to that throughout this passage of Scripture. So now we see the desire of the Jews, and we move on, and now we see the deception of his brethren. Verse 4, they told him to make yourself to the world. Show yourself known to the world. And here they were pretending to care for them. They weren't believers at this time, and they didn't want to see their brother killed or their stepbrother, and so they were tempting him to act in pride and go ahead and get out. But he knew that God had called him there to do that, and he knew his time, and he knew God would protect him there. And so maybe they were a little bit jealous. Can you imagine growing up in a home with Jesus? Maybe the parents said to his stepbrothers, you need to be more like your brother Jesus. You know, and so that would be hard to do, except for maybe when you think about the time he was in the temple, you know, and turning over the tables there and angry. Maybe we're like Jesus during those times, but they didn't believe in it. And so later they did believe, as we see in the Scriptures. But the pretense of the brethren, or the half-brethren, and then the preaching of Jesus, it says he was testifying that their works were evil. He said the things that you're doing are sinful things. And so because he was preaching righteousness and sinfulness against it, they didn't like the preaching of Jesus there. And even during a holy feast, the religion was void because it was religion without Christ. And all religions other than the relationship of Jesus Christ and salvation through him, they're all void. They can't do anything. They can't give hope. They can't save. And so Jesus was preaching the only way of salvation there. Well, there was some disagreement among the people. Not only we saw the desire of the Jews and the deception of his brethren, and they were in a disagreement about who is this person? Who is this Jesus? And that was a common name in those days there, because it's the equivalent to Joshua, the word Joshua in the Old Testament. We see that, and also in the New Testament, it means salvation, and the name Jesus means salvation. And so some people were saying he was a decent man, a good man there in verse 12. They said he's a good man there. The word good means benevolent and helpful. And he had gone around feeding 5,000. He had gone around healing the sick. He was indeed a good man in that sense, because he was helping other people. And so some people recognized that he was a good man. But other people said, no, he's deceiving the people. He might be doing some good things, but he's deceiving the people because he's claiming to be God. And so either he is God or he's not a good man, because a good man is not going around lying and deceiving people and claiming to be God. And so a person must either accept Jesus as who he said he is or reject him altogether. You can't just say he was a good man and he was like one of the prophets, because he wasn't. He was God in the flesh, Emmanuel, as we see his name called there. And so if you've never accepted Jesus Christ as who he claimed to be, the Son of God, and received the salvation that he offers, you have opportunity to receive Christ and be saved, because he is much more than a good man. He is the Son of God and God the Son, who came to earth to die for our sins and rose again the third day. Well, then we come to verse 14. Jesus is there teaching, and we see his doctrine. He says to them in verse 16, "My doctrine is not mine." That word doctrine scares a lot of people there, especially in today's society. There, they will say doctrine is not important. We just need to make sure we love everyone, love God, love Jesus. It's not important. And churches have doctrine. The word doctrine, the Greek word from which this word is translated, we get our English word didactic from it. And that has to do with teaching. Because when Jesus came, he didn't come as a carpenter like Joseph. He didn't come as a farmer. He didn't come as a fisherman like others we see in the scriptures. He came as a teacher. And the word doctrine means teaching. And so the teaching of Jesus is very important. And so the doctrine of the church is very important, if the doctrine is the doctrine of Jesus. And if it's not, then it's really not a New Testament church there. And so there are six aspects of the teaching of Jesus, his doctrine, that we're going to see this morning. The first thing, his doctrine caused astonishment there. It says that the Jews marveled at his teaching, because they said in verse 15, "How knoweth this man letters?" They didn't mean his alphabet. The word letters is the Greek word grammar. Add an R to it and you get our English word grammar there. How does this man understand all of this stuff? He hasn't been to school. He hasn't been to the temple. He hasn't been trained by the elders. They said, neither is he learned in verse 15. And that word means to have a full understanding. And here he was teaching them, and he had a full understanding. Now, we don't have a full understanding. Now, we know more as we study the scriptures and get into them, and God reveals things to us. But one of these days we will. The Bible says now we know in part. But one of these days we're going to have a full understanding. And Jesus had this full understanding, and we know how. They didn't understand. How does he know all these things? Well, the answer is he is God. And God is omniscient. God knows everything. And so God came to earth in the form of flesh and a human body. And he knew everything. And he knew that they were about to kill him, even though they denied it there. And it was clear his brethren knew that they were trying to kill him. And he knew what was going on. And they were astonished at it. Well, also we see something else about the doctrine of Jesus. It says that it came from God. Jesus came from God. In verse 16, it says, Jesus answered them, "My doctrine is not mine, but it's his that sent me there." And whenever we form our doctrine as a church, or your individual doctrine, the teachings, the things you believe, it must be from God. It can't be our opinion. It can't be what's politically correct or anything like that. And so our teaching can't be just tradition, because there may be some traditions that are wrong. If traditions are scriptural, let's hold on to them. If the traditions are not biblical, let's get rid of them. The doctrine of Jesus came from God. And whenever we speak, our speaking must be, as we read so often in the Old Testament, "Thus saith the Lord." It's not my opinion or yours, or just a church constitution, unless it is "Thus saith the Lord." Well, we see the doctrine of Jesus caused astonishment. The doctrine of Jesus came from God. And the doctrine of Jesus is critical to doing God's will. In verse 17, it says, "If any man will do his will, he shall know of the doctrine." Notice the connection between those two words, doing the will of God and knowing the doctrine of God. So if we're going to do God's will, we've got to know doctrine. We've got to know what Jesus was teaching here. And he was there teaching them, and yet they didn't like it sometimes, so they rejected him. And our responsibility is to receive the teaching of Jesus, even if we don't like it. Even if it kind of steps on our toes from time to time, we must know that the doctrine is important because it helps us to do his will. It's not just enough for us to know God's will, but it's important that we do God's will also there. And God doesn't have any interest in revealing knowledge to unwilling people. God doesn't have any interest in revealing knowledge to unwilling people. So therefore, when we go to the scriptures and we're looking for knowledge, we need to say, God, I'm willing to do whatever you reveal. And when we're willing to change any aspects of our lives, or our entertainment, or our habits, or our friends, or our music, or whatever it may be, if we're willing to change and we go to God, then to do his will, he will reveal to us some more doctrinal truth to us if we're willing to do it there. Well, not only was this doctrine of Jesus critical to doing his will, it was contrary to man's will. In verse 8 it says, he that speaks of himself seeks his own glory there. And oftentimes that's what man is doing. He's seeking his own glory. Remember the prophet Isaiah? When he's giving the word from God, and God said, my ways are not man's ways, and my thoughts are not man's thoughts. And man's ways are self-centered and selfish, and there's humanism and atheism that's going on. It's contrary to man's will. God's will is. Man has his own counseling, therapy, and psychology there, because they try to deal with issues of grief and hurt, relationships, anger, and hatred. And man comes up with his own philosophy and psychology and therapy, trying to cure all those things. But the answer is in the Word of God. The doctrine of Jesus, if we follow that, it is the answer to those things, and it's contrary to the teachings of man and what we call humanism today. Also, the doctrine of Jesus concerning the law. Jesus knew that they followed the law of Moses, and so he begins to use that to teach them and bring conviction to them. So in 19, he asked them, did not Moses give you the law, and yet none of you keeps the law? Now we know the book of James tells us that if we try to keep the whole law and we're fail in one point. James says if you're guilty and failing in one point, you're guilty in breaking the whole law. And so they were guilty of not doing the law of God, even as their leader Moses had taught them there. And we can't keep the law. If we are depending on ourselves to keep the law in order to get to heaven, we're going to fail. That's why God sent his son and he gave us grace, because where a sin did abound, grace did much more abound. And so when he asked the question, they in verse 19, after he asked about Moses, he says, will ye go about to kill me? And they answered in verse 20, you have a devil. Who's the one about to kill? Nobody's trying to kill you, Jesus. His brethren knew that they were trying to kill him. And later in the chapter, it tells us that they were trying to kill him. Jesus knew they were trying to kill him. They're calling Jesus a deceiver and a liar. And they're the ones who are being deceptive and lying. And they're trying to be religious and live by the law. And so, but they're not doing a very good job of it. In verse 21, Jesus said, I have done one work. This is reference to the impotent man at the pool of Bethesda, chapter 5. There he says, and ye all marvel, because he had done that work on the Sabbath day. And then he gives them an example from the law of Moses about circumcision there. He tells them in verse 22, Moses gave you circumcision, and on the Sabbath day you circumcise a child. And so here they were keeping the law, and they were circumcising someone on the Sabbath day. And the circumcision, of course, was painful and it brought harm and it took time for healing. And Jesus is using that, and just the opposite is what he's doing. So in verse 23, he says, if a man on the Sabbath day receives circumcision, that the law of Moses should not be broken, are you angry at me? Because I made a man every whit whole on the Sabbath day. So when you practice circumcision, you're not making them whole. You're bringing pain and injury. But I'm making them whole. And you think you're keeping the law, but you're not. They're not having the spirit of the law. And so the law of circumcision was done on the Sabbath, and it's opposite of making people whole. And that's why Jesus came. He came to make people whole. And those who were made whole, like the man at the pool of Bethesda and others that he healed, they eventually died. But Jesus not only came to make people whole of their physical, he could do that today. Even through all the virus and things that's going around in our world, he has the power to heal. But he came to do more than that. He came to make us whole spiritually and to give us a cure for the disease of sin. And it's appointed in a man once to die, and after this, the judgment. And it's because of sin that man dies and is separated from God. But the Lord Jesus came to die there on the cross for us so that we wouldn't have to. And he wants to make you whole today. That's one of the teachings that he had. Then we go to the sixth and final lesson that he had concerning his doctrine. And that is, the doctrine of Jesus commands us to judge. Remember, I said earlier that the world's philosophy and teaching is not like ours, because Isaiah said, my ways are not your ways, saith the Lord. My thoughts are not your thoughts. And the world tells, judge not that you be not judged. And they don't understand the context or the full teaching of Scripture on judging here. And so Jesus says part of his doctrine here commands judging. That's in verse 24. He commands us to do it as well. It says, judge not according to the appearance. So the command there is not, don't judge, it's don't judge according to appearance. The rest of the verse says, but judge righteous judgment. That's a command. He commands us to judge, but not according to appearance. He commands us to judge righteous judgment there. And not just according to what you see outwardly. The Jews there were judging Jesus, but they were doing it outwardly. According to appearance, they didn't know anything about righteousness. They weren't judging Jesus rightly there. This word judge can also be translated discriminate. And we often use that word because we don't discriminate based on outward appearance. We don't discriminate between a person being black and a person being white. Those are outward things. We don't discriminate based on nationality. But we do discriminate on what is right and wrong. And that's what Jesus is teaching. The word judgment, as a judge does in court, he makes a judgment. He makes a sentence. He makes a decision. And so the Bible says, when we look at actions that are going around the world, and especially even actions in our own lives, we need to make a decision, a judgment. Is that right or is it wrong? And it doesn't matter who's doing it or how popular they are, or what the world has to say, or what political correctness may say. If it is wrong, we make a judgment against those actions and issues. He doesn't say judge people. He says to judge righteous judgment there. And so we, as God's people, are commanded to judge. We're commanded to judge sin. Stealing is a sin. We make a judgment on that. Lying is a sin. Cheating is a sin. God has created marriage for one man and one woman there. And anything other than that is outside the teaching of Scriptures, and we make a judgment that all other physical relation is sin. We make that judgment because it is right in accordance with the Word of God. Then we move on to the next thing. As Jesus was teaching, there was the debate about his origin. And so they didn't quite understand. They knew that Jesus was from Nazareth. And they said, well, the Messiah, he's not coming from Nazareth. We don't know where the Messiah's origin is. And so here, this debate about his origin was confusing to man. It says, do the rulers know indeed that this is the very Christ? Do they know that this is the Messiah? No one really was understanding all of this at this time there, but they had some knowledge of the scriptures. They knew about circumcision, they knew about the Messiah, they knew that he was coming, and having a little bit of scripture without having the Spirit of God inside a person is dangerous, because they take all the scriptures and they don't understand it. And so the Bible teaches us in the New Testament that the Holy Spirit comes to dwell within us the moment that we're saved. And we have understanding of scripture. Doesn't mean we know everything, but as we pray and read the scriptures, we come to know more and more. But we want to take scripture, compare it with scripture, and see how the Holy Spirit leads us through the Word of God. So not only was it confusing to man, but it was clarified by Jesus. Jesus made it pretty clear. He says, I am from him, and he has sent me. I came from God, and he was eternally the Son of God, and God the Father is the one who sent me. And so he's making it clear to them. And isn't that what teachers do? When students don't understand a lesson, teachers clarify it. And today's society, they clarify it online. So whether it's in the classroom or whether it's online, they clarify things. And Jesus is making it clear, I came from God, and he is the one that sent me there. Well, notice what it says after that when he says that I came from God, and he's the one that sent me. Verse 30 says, then, what did they do when Jesus made it very clear that he is God and came from God? Then, verse 30 says, they sought to take him, but no man laid hands on him because his hour was not yet come. And so we see his getaway here. So Jesus, he gets out of there. Now, he wasn't afraid to die. We know the scripture tells us he didn't die and go to the cross at this particular time because his hour had not come. Jesus would choose when he would go to the cross, and the sinful men that would eventually crucify him, they weren't going to determine when and how Jesus met his death there. And so Jesus knew God's timing. And what he was doing, he was going to do in God's timing. There's an application for us as well. There's some things that God allows to come into our lives that we might not understand, but God's timing is always right. God knows what he's doing. His time had not yet come, and sometimes the time of the solution for which we are looking and the troubles we face, God says, it's not time yet. But he knows the time. He knows what he's doing. We can trust him. He does all things well. He does all things for our good. And so his getaway was not just because he was afraid to die, which we know he wasn't. That was the reason he came. And so now we see his destiny here. His destiny was Golgotha, otherwise known as Calvary. His hour was not yet come. He would eventually let them take him to Golgotha. He would eventually let them take him to Calvary. He would eventually let them drive the nails through his hands and his feet and lift him up on the cross there. He would let them do it when his hour was come, because when he left heaven's glory, that was the very reason God sent him here, was to come and go to Golgotha, to Calvary, the other name for it there. It's why he came. He came to go to the cross there. And that's part of his doctrine as well, the teaching of the Word of God, that Jesus Christ is the only Savior of the world. And that's why he came. In conclusion, three questions that we can ask ourselves this morning. Do you know him? Not just about him. Not the story of Jesus and the incarnation and the teaching of Jesus and the temple and the miracles and the parables and knowing those things. There's a difference in knowing about him and knowing him personally. And we know him when we receive him into our hearts and lives through salvation. Second question we ask ourselves, do you know his doctrine? And are you doing it? It's important for us to know the doctrine of the scriptures. And the only way to know that is to read it. and study it and be in the Word daily to know the teachings of Jesus, and not just to acquire knowledge and say, I know more about the Bible than so and so, but to do it. Again, God has no interest in revealing knowledge to those who are unwilling to do His will. And the third and final question we ask ourselves this morning, do you judge righteous judgment as commanded? And so about what we believe, do I make decisions about what I believe? Is it scriptural about my actions, about my lifestyle? Do I make judgments about other issues and things? Are they right or wrong? And if they are, they're not going to be a part of my life. And I'm going to stand firmly and let the world know, as Jesus did, that those are sinful things. We don't judge people, but we certainly do judge issues and actions, whether or not they are right or wrong. Not my opinion, not what the majority of the world says. What does God say? Is it right or wrong? That is the doctrine of Jesus. He came to bring righteousness, and we teach what is right according to God's word. Let's pray. Our Father, we thank you for the righteousness of Christ and for his willingness to give us that righteousness. We can't make ourselves righteous. We are certainly far from righteous in our sinful conditions in which we were born. But we can have the righteousness of Christ whenever we trust Christ as our Savior. And we thank you that when we do that, he takes away all of our sins. And he gives us the righteousness of Christ so that one day, when we stand before God, we stand not in our own deeds and our own works, our own righteousness, but we stand only in the righteousness of Christ. We thank you that it was for me he died, and for me he lives. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Would you stand together as we sing a hymn of invitation? 311, More About Jesus. Would you join in as we sing? We'll sing just one stanza this morning. 311.
Father, we do thank you that we could gather together. And Father, even though we couldn't all be here together as normal, we thank you that this room is special as it is for us to come and worship you together. It's not the be-all and end-all, Father. We thank you that our church expands beyond here because of the believers that are at home watching and listening and praying and singing. And Father, we thank you that we can worship you whether we're here or at home. Father, we ask that you would help us to continue to be that church as we find ways to minister to our community now. Father, I pray that you would allow us to be a light and testimony to those that are in a time of concern and worry and fear. I pray that we would place our trust and our hope in you, Father. God, you are so much greater than anything. We thank you that you are not caught off guard by this. We thank you that this is not bothering you, that you are not worried about how it's going to happen. God, you have a great plan. And we are eager to see what your plan is. Father, we ask that you would be with those that are ill, help them to recover from their illnesses. Give us, those of us that are healthy, the stamina to remain healthy. And Father, I pray that you would just help us all to be there for each other, and to worship you, and to look for you. In your name we pray.